Being 7:02, we'll call the meeting to order. First item on the agenda is acceptance of the agenda.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the agenda for August 4th, 2009.
Second.
Discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Watkins? No Watkins. Item number three, the vote of the joint vote of the Planning Board and Board of Selectmen has been postponed until September, I think the first week of September. So now the Planning Board can properly interview the candidates.
Right, we don't make a motion.
No motion.
Number four, Hawkers Peddlers. Just get that.
How are you today?
How are you?
Good evening.
Good, good.
How are we moving along down there, all right?
Moving along fantastically.
Good.
Yep.
Looks like we have a couple of
licenses,
a Hawker Peddler license to give out tonight, is that right?
Yes, correct.
And everything's been cleared?
Yes.
With?
Got the Board of Health, we got the
permits.
Yep, we got the permits, got everything, so everything is above board and.
Okay.
Starting tomorrow, Mark, are you?
Gonna start tomorrow. That's our plan.
Jennifer Lamb's gone, right? Is she around, I wonder?
I talked to her, Joe. In fact, I dialed her number by mistake this afternoon, and I was trying to reach Al. First I got treasure collected, yep. I thought I knew the number. But anyway, I had talked to her about this, and
yep.
She didn't seem to have any problems.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah, she told us about the eggs at a certain temperature, yep. The lobsters, we okay. Went through that. She has all her licenses.
Okay.
Division of State of Fisheries.
Okay.
So everything's above board.
Motion.
Yeah, the only question I have, Mark, is I just want to make sure that we keep it towards the farmer's market. You know, initially we were talking about fruits and vegetables, and now yes. We're spinning off to other things. So just, you know, just keep track of that so it
exactly.
Doesn't, you know.
And I have a few questions to you. There were a few people saying that they wanted to come and join. I'm like, well, you have to go through protocol.
Right.
And that's it. Come up here, fill out the form, and go in front of Selectmen, and that's what I've got. But what if somebody shows up without one? Am I the policeman that says, you can't come in here?
Yes.
That's the deal.
Yeah.
You got it. Okay. Yeah. I don't have an issue there.
Only because, you know, we really don't.
Right, exactly. I don't want this thing to explode into something way out of control. No.
And I think we want to keep it towards food items
exactly.
As opposed to, you know, I know it's little trinkets and stuff that we're selling along the side there too.
Right, but we're going to keep
yeah,
it.
As a
and hours of operation?
3 to 7.
On?
Wednesdays.
Wednesdays. You know, and this probably is a little off, but only because we're talking about that parking lot, so I bring it up now. Maybe I'll tell you what, I'll bring it up by the other business. Scott, let's vote this.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant Hawkers Peddlers licenses to Michael and Jessica Lane doing business as Lane's Lobsters, Lisa Talbot doing business as Something Sweet, Baked Goods, Elizabeth Flaherty, Eggs, Produce, and Photographs, Steverman's Farm, Produce, and Cut Flowers to sell items at the North Scituate town-owned commuter rail parking lot in front of the WPA building from 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. on Wednesdays from now until the last week in October 2009. This license has a temporary waiver of the 15-minute rules, Selectmen's Policy Number 43-99.
Second.
Okay, discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Good luck.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it. Hope we'll see you there tomorrow.
It's okay.
Good luck,
Mark. Number five, Cable Television Trust Fund / Cable TV Advisory Committee, Vinnie Mary.
And Rich.
Sorry, Rich. I think what we're just looking for tonight, and you certainly gave us backup, would be to answer any questions that the board might have regarding that backup information.
First, I just want to thank you guys for getting it. It was very helpful. Most of the questions have been answered via email coming back and forth. One that I had,
sorry.
Rich, I don't know if you got my last one regarding the hosting.
Yes. There was an email from Tom Rose regarding that. It is being hosted by Vario.
Right. No, no, the question, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Go ahead.
The one I sent later this afternoon dealt more with the fact that we have two hosting. We host the school and the town.
Yes.
And the town is about $400 a year, and the school is about $3,400 a year.
Yeah.
So I didn't know what the difference was. I mean, what the difference in terms of what Vario was providing differently to the town than to the school?
Well, it's actually, those fees are not actually for hosting itself. They're for the monthly maintenance as well as development and use of the online report card system for the elementary schools. So that's a labor charge from Tom Rose. And then the number that I gave you was based on the fees that he charged the school for the previous year.
So that $3,000 is another item that's going to Tom Rose?
That's correct.
So he's... So he gets paid from the town for services there, a maintenance retainer type thing. Gets paid by the school for a retainer there, and then he gets paid for the web hosting for the school as well. So there's several different buckets that pay his services.
That's right.
And then I also sent you responded to me regarding the monitors. And you said you got a cheaper price than that. So
that's correct.
I guess my question, I'm sure Joe's going to ask in a second, is what are we actually looking to pass tonight? I know the town side is pretty easy. It's this $11,000.
Well, I sent over as part of my documentation a spreadsheet called 2009-10 planned budget items. Mm-hmm. If you don't have a copy of it, I have a copy here.
Yeah, no, I got it.
It's the last two pages.
Everyone has that? Now, these are the items that have been planned as expenditures for the year. And if you notice that the total there is $114,000. Now, my budget through the schools is $60,000. So that leaves a shortfall of $54,000. So the cable budget makes that up. And if you notice, one of the items near the bottom is miscellaneous emergency. And there's only $4,000 in there, which is not a lot of money to have as a stopgap in case the server goes down and that kind of thing. So I think that the $53,000 that I'm asking for is pretty reasonable. And you know, it's hard to say that I'll expend exactly $114,000, but it's going to be pretty darn close. So it doesn't leave me a lot of leeway in case there's unforeseen circumstances.
I understand. We're just kind of being really tight in terms of the town side, so to be kind of open in terms of the school side doesn't seem to be consistent. And again, if we have an emergency here on the town side, then you know they would come before us and ask for the $4,000. I don't know, how does the board feel on... I mean, this is really our only IT reserve for the fiscal year that we're going into, so I think on many different items, we've said, if we don't need it right now, let's hold off in case something catastrophic does happen and we do need these funds later. We don't have to actually allocate them now. So, you know, I don't know if we need the 50 monitors.
Well, my plan is to put a lab in at Wampatuck. That's 25 computers and monitors. A lab at Gates, to another 25 computers and monitors. Also upgrading or converting Wampatuck from an Apple, a Mac-based school system to a PC-based school system. So there's another 25 computers and monitors for the staff, as well as a server. And then a lab up at the high school, which is 20 computers and monitors, and then additional computers and monitors to replace aging equipment at the high school and also at Gates. So that brings the total computers and monitors to 125. And I have plans for every single one of those before the school year even starts. So for example, I've got my computers and monitors for Gates, for the high school, for the gates in the high school, that's 75, and I'm waiting for this process to finish so that I can get the 50 that I need for Wampatuck. And so that's really a big question mark. I'd really like to be able to order those tomorrow, but I can't do anything until I get the thumbs up from you people. So that's where I'm at this point. I'm basically, my pattern has been to go through 75% or better of my entire budget mm-hmm. in the summertime, getting right. projects done. So for me to have to wait any more at all is gonna seriously hamstring the efforts that I'm trying to complete this summer.
Yeah, I don't think I'm suggesting waiting. I'm just saying, is it all critical? You know what I mean? Is it all?
Well,
you know, I understand if you've got a project going in at Wampatuck, you need 50 laptop or 50 CPUs, then you buy them. Because it's going to that. But I'm saying if some of this stuff is not critical and it can be held in abeyance,
well,
then...
The miscellaneous emergency, we can hope nothing happens. Hub retainer, we can hope nothing happens. I'd prefer to have those guys on retainer because their response time is much faster than have a retainer there. Almost everything on there is going to have to be purchased at some point this year. Some things are later than others. You know, some of the support contracts aren't due until in April of next year. So there is a little bit of leeway there, but essentially 90% of what I'm asking for, 95% of what I'm asking for is going to have to be purchased this year.
Mr. Chair?
Tony?
Yeah, I just, well, I hear what you hear.
Yeah. Rick?
Yeah, Rich, first of all, it's nice to meet you after hearing so many good things about you. It's good to see you face to face. I don't have any problem with any of the line items one by one and for the town side or for the school side per se, and I'm very hesitant to get involved too much on the school side because I'm really not versed in that. But overall, and I think you saw the emails that I sent to Kim that she... thankfully distributed around. My whole feeling on this, though, is just philosophically, is do we want to be spending money on this? Or what do we need to spend money on now, assuming or with knowledge that we might be revamping the whole sort of IT interrelationships in the very near future? And so just to preserve whatever capital we may or may not have. I'm not going to be going through, I mean, I do look at 50 LCD monitors, and I'm encouraged that these are going to be new. They're not just replacements and that sort of stuff. They're going to be something. They're going to result in a tangible computer lab at two different schools, and I'm encouraged by that. And I appreciate you educating me about that. But I just, my concerns are overall is, what can we do to preserve every single last nickel that we can of this money, knowing that next spring town meeting or even shortly thereafter or even before, we might need even small amounts of money just to make sure that the schools can communicate better with town hall, can communicate better with the fire. I mean, as Mr. Danahy brings up, we had the fire people in here, Chief Judge, you know, 3 months ago saying he absolutely needed 25,000 or 17,000 or whatever it was to get that going. And that's the sort of the scale of the monies that we have here. And so that's where I'm coming from. So I'm not going to go through and line item pick at things, but I really do wonder what of this do we need to. And last week or 2 weeks ago, I made the motion and took the proactive view of, okay, I understand the 15,000 or 12,000, whatever it was, because you had some contracts up. And I completely understand that. But any of the other hardware expenditures, I'm just hesitant about. All right, that's where I'm coming from. So... I don't know what that means, if I'm in favor or against, but I'm just sort of to throw that out there for the discussion.
Well, I mean, there is a proposal to upgrade the server side of the school systems, especially at the high school, but that's completely outside of what we're talking about here, which is client hardware.
Yep.
And regardless of, of what we do, if we just sit on our server infrastructure or we completely upgrade anything, that really doesn't change anything as far as the clients go. Just okay. Maybe how they connect to the new servers. But
okay, now you said you're going to be converting a whole bunch of the school stuff from Macs to PCs.
Yes.
And how does that fit into the larger plan of, I don't know, what's the balance now? Are these going to be the only PCs, and now we're going to have 10% PCs and 90% Macs, or vice versa? Are these the last few Macs hanging around?
Well, we've got four elementary schools.
Yeah.
They're all Mac schools, except for Hatherley, which was converted last year.
Yeah.
Now, it's not really in the budget to convert them all at once, so I'm doing one school a year. So that results in just
from your school budget?
From the
school budget.
Budget,
yeah, okay.
And that requires about 50 units, PCs and monitors, to be able to convert them. And then the Macs that are still functioning at that school get redistributed amongst the remaining Mac schools so that everybody gets an influx of...
So the plan is to convert all the schools over 4 or 5 years, so it's an entirely PC-based environment?
That's right.
Okay.
Anything else? I mean, I just...
No, you answered the question I was going to ask you, Mr. Long. The only question I have is, and it's the same thing, if it's a priority, fine. If not, my push is always to say, if we can hold off and if it's an emergency, you can come back to the board, fine, we'll vote it. I'll vote anything that's an emergency you need. But if it's all necessary, fair enough. And that's what I'm hearing, except for maybe two of the items.
That's what we have decided. We can go till midnight tonight, but until we find out what is, quote, necessary and what is expendable, can be put out. Until we find that out, we can't come up with any number. Now, it may be, if you sit here and say it's all absolutely necessary, that gives us a yes or no vote.
Let's vote it.
And you know,
that's it.
But we don't have here, I wouldn't know if I made a motion now what motion to make, because I don't know what the total necessary items are, and maybe they all are for all, you know.
Well, with the exception of those two items that I mentioned,
everything else would be
100% essential to accomplish the goals that I have for this year.
So that's the 4,000 miscellaneous emergency, and what else?
And the hub retainer, which is 5,000, and those are just kind of insurance items, which are, you know, I very much like to have them because, like I said, when an emergency comes down, we'd like to be able to get on top of it. But
you won't not have them. It's just that you might not have them.
Might
leaving,
not need them.
We
you know,
might not have them leaving this room tonight.
Yeah,
but they'll be there, and if something comes up to that takes precedent over them, and it'd be your job to say no, this is more important. You know.
Yeah.
So Sean,
I was just going to say, so if we back out the five and then the four and the five, they'd have to come back before us. If we vote the 114, I think they heard us loud and clear.
No, we vote 53
well, actually,
minus 9.
What I'm asking for is 53,000.
Okay, so if we vote 53
minus 9,
that'd be 44.
All right, 53 and 44. If we vote 44, they have to come before us for the other 9. If we vote 53, then I think they heard us loud and clear.
That's
don't spend it unless you have to. I mean,
there's
our town accountant. If we, no one knows better than her.
Yep.
You know,
that's basically what it comes down to.
I agree. The thing that I see is we're kind of holding two different standards. You know, we're holding the town's foot to the fire, and we're not the school in terms of this money, which we allocate. It's not supposed to go to the school. It's not supposed to go to the town. It's money that we, as the selectmen, get to allocate. And you know, the school, which I am in favor of, you know, a lot of the items here aren't maintenance. I mean, Mary's given us bills that are just services. It's annual services we need to host our website. You're expanding, you're upgrading stuff, which I know if you two had your qualms, you would be doing that also.
We spend every nickel.
Right. Yeah. So it's, you know, I just see, and this probably is not, this may not be the year that we, to make these drastic changes, because it hasn't been the way it's been in the past, but I just see the inconsistencies in terms of, we're saying to the town, okay, hey, here's your bare essentials, you can have your internet, you can have this, but you're not buying these new PCs. Yet, you know, to the school, we're saying, okay, go, you know, it's like the line item, here's 50 grand, go spend on what you want, because you could say in here, if you wanted to, you know, the school's budget is paying everything except the CPUs, and they're essential, so I need the 50 grand for that, you know? So, I mean, it all depends on how, like Sean said, I think we're getting our point across. Maybe we don't have to implement it as strictly as we've talked about.
Okay.
If I just may say, I'll defer to your discretion, both of you, okay? I guess the point is that you're the professionals, and obviously we just don't want to hear that it turns out that, you know, it's a waste. That's the bottom line. And you know what? If that's what you're looking for, if that's all I'm asking you to tell me. If you're telling me it's necessary, it's essential, I'll vote it.
It's absolutely essential.
All right.
These are not plans that we just kind of come up with all of a sudden. This is stuff that's been in planning and documentation since before I even started, and it's just kind of the realization, you know, in order to stick with the goal of upgrading a certain percentage of equipment, these items are essential to be able to do that.
With the exception of the 9,000.
Exactly.
Yeah. So I'm in favor of the changing the motion to have that last line, instead of being 53,047.40, have it be 44,047.40.
You want to put that in the form of a motion? That,
can I ask just one quick question?
I just want to make sure I'm getting the right figure right. Yeah, okay.
Who is Hub Retainer? What company is that?
That's Hub Technical. They're the same company that...
Oh, those are the people that did the fire stuff?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, don't we have a retainer with them from the town side also?
You see, this is exactly my point about
shouldn't that
getting
be?
The architecture all together.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did we? Well, it would be the same amount. I mean, whether it was
15 from you and 10, right?
Yeah.
Did we give you? Did we pass your retainer for them?
Yes, you did.
Then I guess we should.
The
pass
advantage to keeping it somewhat separate is that we're not dipping into each other's retainer.
We're not dipping it.
So.
All right. Let's do the.
Well, you may. We did pass the Hub retainer for the town, so.
So I'll put 5 back. Maybe take away 4. 49. Okay. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant the request of the Cable Television Advisory Committee for $11,092 for the town side and $49,047.40 for the school side from the Cable Trust Fund. And I got that 49 because I put the Hub back in.
Motion has been made and seconded. Further discussion from the board or the floor? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Unanimous. Done.
So, Vinny and Mary, why don't you come back to us next meeting with the rest of your... I mean, this is good to go through just so we understand what we're having, you know, to say, okay, I didn't know we had internet service there, or I didn't realize it cost us this much to run our website. I mean, that's where it's educational for me to look at this stuff. So thanks for putting it together.
Actually, before you guys go, just a related question, just while we're all here. What is the status of getting the Conservation Commission Planning Board and Zoning Board televised?
Can I ask you
in terms of our meetings?
This goes into a discussion of the philosophy of community television and how the whole apparatus works. I mean, it's no further along than it was a month ago or 2 months ago or 3 months ago. We need a facility in order to establish the community television station to start to function as we're required to under the contract, which would include getting interns in here, getting other people involved, getting volunteers involved to operate the equipment. The station manager, we don't have enough hours with the station manager to televise all the meetings.
Okay.
He's actually doing a lot of other things right now.
I see this is a larger issue. Maybe we could have this as an agenda item soon. Because this
I spoke to Vinny.
It's okay. Because a lot of us have been talking about getting these things televised for a long time, and I absolutely understand what you're saying, Vinny, but I just want to make sure this maintains momentum and we get a plan in order to do this sooner rather than later.
Put it on a future agenda.
Yeah, that would be great. Okay. Thanks. Sorry, Tony.
No, Vinny was planning to do it. Maybe I don't know when you're on vacation, but make sure.
Yeah, well, I'm on vacation next 2 weeks, starting on Saturday. Coming back, we're supposed to have a meeting with Trish and with Tony and everybody on this very topic.
Great.
Just to sit down and then to present the options.
Perfect.
To the Board of Selectmen. So you guys are the ultimate people to make the decision whether we have a private corporation, a nonprofit, or it's going to be run by you guys. And there's a lot of ramifications of these things. So we want to make sure we have a solid presentation so we can sit down and talk.
Well, have that meeting when you get finished with it.
Yep. Let's do it up.
Ask for agenda
time.
Like
the first week of September.
Right.
Just one quick point to that is, you know, we allocate the funds to that cable grant, so we can allocate the money for John to start televising the other meetings immediately. I mean, if it's just hours for,
right.
If that's what we choose to do, right?
Yeah. But
I mean, if it's in this room,
it's in the room.
There's just so many hours in the day. That's the only thing. And I mean, we Tony, we can sit down and discuss it, and as being a liaison, maybe we could figure out between us something. If it can be done, we can do it, certainly.
But I like the way you're thinking on that one.
All right. Agenda item number six. Thank you all. Discussion and after-school commission. Sean, maybe Sean could be the expert on this, bring us up to date.
About, I don't know, time goes by so quick. Maybe 6 months ago, Jen, myself, and Rick met to discuss forming an after-school commission. It seemed that a lot of programs that the elementary schools were running conflicted with rec programs and so forth. And for a lot of different reasons, they thought if they formed a commission, and it's kind of outlined here, made up by a member of the Selectmen School Committee and rec, that PTOs and so forth, and some of these other organizations, course as well, could go to this group ultimately to get the approval for an after-school program. It's made a lot of sense. Some PTOs are more active than others, so they might have a better after-school programs than some of the other elementary schools. So last week was kind of an unofficial meeting. Mrs. Bowen, Jim Kelleher, a member of the recreation, myself sat down and ironed out a lot of these details and where the commission might go. So I said we'd have to come back here and vote a member from this board that would be a voting member on that commission. So anyone has any other questions, I'll try to answer.
So what we're going to do tonight is just to appoint a member of this board to that commission.
Exactly.
To be our liaison.
At first I thought maybe, you know, I would do it and where I'm liaison to recreation, but and then after I thought about it and I talked to Tony, and if you other guys feel left out, jump in, but my children aren't in the elementary school anymore. Tony's liaison to school and he didn't mind. And I said I'd take, you know, something of his, a liaison position from him. And if he didn't mind, and he seemed to volunteer before I even had to ask him.
Any questions, Tony, thoughts? Yeah. Tony has spoken.
I'll do it if you want, unless someone else has an interest. You can thumb wrestle for it.
It would be a quarterly, 3 or 4 times a year, something like that. Didn't think, nothing's going to change this fall. We thought January, spring, second half of the school year at the earliest.
I just have one question, John. You said Jennifer, yourself, and Rick got this group together to start this.
No, not necessarily. We sat in this room one afternoon and just spoke about
Rick Agnew?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. So if the board, if there agrees, we'll ask Tony to be our representative to that after school commission.
Sounds great.
Okay. I don't know if we need a motion. Probably not.
I have one other comment about
this. Rick Murray.
If I could. I'm pleased to see at the bottom here it says, you know, all meetings will be open and posted and all that sort of stuff. And minutes from their meetings will be at the town's clerk's office, which brings up a subject. Who's going to take the minutes, and would that be a secretary sort of paid for from the town, which I would support? And I just want to bring Tricia up to speed that we've had in the last couple of years 2 new commissions, the Historical Commissions and Water Resources Committee, that meet monthly, and we don't have secretary support for them because, according to Mr. Agnew, there wasn't money for that. But I just want to make sure that if we do start new commissions, which I think this is a great one to do, by the way, that we also provide them with adequate support so they can do their business efficiently and effectively. And so I just want to make sure that we don't sort of give a unfunded mandate, as it were, to these commissions that start up. And so I completely support this. And when it says minutes from the meetings, I hope we can find a secretary, evening secretary, particularly since it's 4 or 5 times a year at most. And also perhaps we can address this with those other commissions too. That's my only comment.
Good. Very good. So no motion necessary, and we just did it. Next is the drainage easement to Glenn. Laura?
Hi,
How are you?
Thanks. You want me to give a little summary?
Yeah, just, I think we're very familiar with the whole situation, so just...
Are you here to answer any questions that you might have?
This is on the easement that we talked about in the past?
Yeah, I think it's not technically an easement, it's just an agreement between the town and the developers of this project, that the developers will maintain the drainage even though it's in a public way.
Yep.
It's going to be in Summer Street. So...
Discussion from the board, questions from the board?
Part of the contract, so it's not really...
No, it's kind of cut dry all...
Is it going to be in the right-of-way? It's going to be in a public right-of-way?
Yeah. Yeah, that was the only way for them to do it. They're kind of shipping drainage from one part of the development down to another, and they're using Summer Street to make the connection.
Has Al seen the specs and everything? All right.
Yeah, the agreement that was used came from him. It came from his office. It's a standard agreement that they use, that DPW has used before.
Okay.
So if I understand correctly, we've got support from you as the town planner, support from the planning board because of special permit, support from Al. So everybody signed off on this.
Doesn't sound like any objections. Any objections from anyone? If not, entertain a motion.
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to approve that a drainage line be installed in Summer Street according to, one, engineering plan that has been approved by the Department of Public Works. Two, all costs associated with this project are borne by the developer owner. And three, that the work, when completed, shall be inspected by the Department of Public Works and completed to the Department of Public Works' satisfaction.
Second.
Further discussion, seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you. Thank you. Good luck.
Thanks.
Agenda item number 8. This is a vote authorizing authorization to sign state revolving funds. This would be giving Tricia, as town administrator, the authorization to do that.
You want a motion?
I'd love one.
I didn't know if, Patricia, did you have anything to comment on this? Is this all within the normal?
No, it's standard format to do it for the application.
In order to do bonding, you have to have this.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to authorize the town administrator to act on behalf of the board as its agent in filing applications for, executing agreements regarding, and performing any and all other actions necessary to secure for the town of Scituate such loans and/or grants for construction or planning of water pollution abatement projects as may be made available to the town of Scituate pursuant to the provisions of the Massachusetts Clean Waters Act, Mass General Law Chapter 21, Section 27-33E, inclusive as amended, and the Water Pollution Abatement Revolving Loan Program, Mass General Laws, Chapter 29C, for the Roses Lane Area Sewer Project Contract 09-WW-01.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Al.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm here this evening to request that you award a contract for the engineering, permitting, and construction bidding for repair of seawalls. In April of 2007, the Northeaster storm was declared a disaster by FEMA. That was then accompanied by a grant from them to pay 75% of the repair costs for 20 or so specifically damaged areas on the seawall running from Minot all the way through to Humorock. The town raised its 25% share, which is $240,000. That match came from money previously allocated to seawall repair, as well as from Article 4, Item O, at the April 2009 town meeting. The DPW is now ready to move forward with these repairs, and we recommend that the town award the contract for the waterfront engineering to the firm Vine Associates of Hingham, with whom we've had extensive experience. There are a very limited number of firms that will do this kind of work with the expertise that we need to ensure that the seawalls are maintained properly and repaired properly. Vine Associates has been involved with the town since 2000 in doing surveys and assessments and inventories of our seawalls, has been a consultant to the town on areas of damage and how to properly accommodate to accomplish repairs, and was instrumental in helping us obtain this FEMA grant. So with that, I'll open it to questions if you have.
Start with Rick.
Oh, okay. Just looking at the sites in the, on this letter to you from Vine, and it gives the FEMA project worksheet number, and it mentions Rebecca Road. Is this the portion of the wall that Dave Ball has been talking about for a while, or is that something separate? I know Dave's been talking to myself and I think John as well, but I'm not exactly sure where on Rebecca Road this is.
Yeah. This on Rebecca Road is much further out near the lighthouse.
Okay. Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
And this will be interesting because the FEMA walked the walls with our in-house expert Paul Scott, as well as with Vine's expert Peter Williams, and FEMA then declared that this section of the wall is damaged because of the northeast storm. This adjacent section of the wall is merely eroded. They'll only pay for the sections that were damaged by the storm. And there's, if it's science or art or guesswork, nonetheless, they have identified these 20 or so specific areas of the wall that were damaged by this particular storm. And it's only those areas are areas where we can apply their grant money for the repairs.
Okay. And they'll access that by getting in the same way they have in the past, up on the end of Rebecca Road near the lighthouse, come down that way?
Right.
Okay.
Or they may exit from, I said correct, it'll depend on the specific site. There's somewhere that it can only be accessed from the sea by barge.
Yeah.
So the equipment may come in on barge, and then the stones reset.
Yeah.
Okay?
Got it. Excellent. Thanks.
Tony?
The money that we're allocating tonight is just for the engineering, right? Not the actual...
This is for engineering, permitting, construction bidding, construction recommendation of...
Not actually moving rocks.
Correct.
Okay.
And then it'll be for, on a time and materials basis, for helping us with construction management. And that's more of a consulting basis. We'll assign one of our engineers to be on the site during the actual construction repair. But we'll call upon Vine for an occasional piece of expertise. Is the density of the concrete that's being used proper, those sorts of things.
Now, just so everyone understands, this is money that we allocated at the capital plan. We allocated $120,000. We thought that the state was going to give $120,000, but that didn't happen.
Correct.
So we took $120,000 from a prior seawall article or
yes.
allocation, and the state or FEMA is giving $750,000 towards
that. That's correct.
So that was the whole rationale, as you remember, behind putting the 120 in, because you're getting 750 out of it.
And the we're under some time pressure, unfortunately, because the FEMA grant has had to be extended several times because the work was going on with the state using elected representatives and others to try to encourage the state to come up with their portion of the funds. The delays occurred, and we've keep asking for extensions of our FEMA contract. We have that in hand. We've got, we need to complete this work within essentially 11 months now. And there's no panic with that. We can do that, provided we get started on engineering, get the bids out. Some of the work obviously cannot be done during the winter period, but we'll be able to show good faith with FEMA and get the project done on time.
And that FEMA money's a lock. That
FEMA money is locked unless we muff it.
Gentlemen, further questions?
Yes, go ahead.
Tony cleared it all up for me. That's what I thought. I was trying to write it down and follow the train of thought here, the follow the money. So this doesn't include any construction, such as like Lynch might, who's done it in the past for us.
Right.
It does not include what we've owned.
Right. The construction will be competitively bid. There are relatively few firms that will do that. We've used SM Lynch extensively in the past. If they if they are the appropriate bidder and we're confident in their work, which we are, then they would be awarded the contract. If there are others out there that come back with a better deal, then we would perhaps recommend them as the alternative if we think they're adequate.
John?
Yeah, just Al, I know that you and I had met and talked about some of the other areas in town, but these are areas that have been ranked according to the plan, the booklet that the town has put in place in the F category, if I'm not mistaken. Is that
yes.
correct? And I know that, you know, usually the town goes out along with the consultant every so many years to take a look at the wall or the entire walls of Scituate to determine where they fall, if, in essence, from a A being a grade to an F being a, being in disregard or disrepair. Is there any plan in the future? I'm not sure how far back the recent review was. Is there a plan to kind of take a look at the walls going forward? And if so, when?
We are going to be looking at programmatically how do we tackle the other seawall repairs in town. I don't want to say we were fortunate that we had a storm that damaged some seawalls and we got some federal money, but there is virtually no other money available from outside resources to make repairs to town or private seawalls. And it's, again, through the inventory, adjacent to what is a town wall is a identical-looking private wall built, funded privately. So we'll come back at some point and have to make some fairly severe recommendations about how can the town go forward to accomplish repairs to seawalls in the future. We can't rely upon federal money. We did in the ARA, whatever it's called, the ARA funding seawall, money for seawall was in that request. It was not forthcoming. Went to the auto industry instead.
I was going to say, like the rebate?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to, Nell, I apologize we didn't have a chance to talk about that. If the board could amend the motion and just award the construction and permitting piece tonight as opposed to the construction management service. I noticed, Al, you've asked for $35,000. There's an original estimate from the proposal for $33,000, but that they'll have a better idea once they actually prepare the construction documents. So I'd rather suggest that you just award the first piece, the $54,000 plus, and then once those documents have actually been compiled, we can get a formal proposal for construction management and have a better idea of the actual cost, and Al can bring that back at that point.
So we'll entertain a motion for the $54,279.
Move that the board of...
Go ahead, Sean, go ahead. Move that the board of selectmen vote to award the contract for engineering, permitting and construction bidding to repair seawalls damaged in the April 2007 storm to Vine Associates of Hingham, Massachusetts, in the amount of $54,279.
A second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That's unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Al.
Thanks, Al.
A couple of resignations from the Scituate Cultural Council. Motion.
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the resignations of Nancy Murray Young and Colleen Ellis from the Scituate Cultural Council, and further that the Board of Selectmen thank both Ms. Young and Ms. Ellis for their service to the council and to the town of Scituate.
Second.
Just a note, that of course leaves two openings, I would say, Kim, right?
Yes. Correct.
On that very important council, and if anyone was... anyone is interested, please notify Town Hall, Kim, or, and she could fill you in on what it entails. It's not a extremely heavy meeting schedule, I don't believe, but what the work they do is very important. So if anyone is interested in serving on that committee, and basically what it is, a state gives the town X number of dollars for cultural activities. There is a committee that receives that money, accepts requests for that money, and then makes decisions on who's going to get it, whether it be a youth groups or, I forget, they give out quite a few grants, I guess we'll call it, for lack of a better word. All right, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Motion and second?
Motion and second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That's unanimous. Thank you. A new item on our agenda is the town administrator's report. In the past, we've kind of lumped it all under other business, but this is much more efficient, I think. And Tricia, John.
Thank you. This is probably the shortest and easiest one I'll have to write, so I'm going to take advantage of it. And I suspect it will get longer and be broken out to specific categories like finance, personnel, or whatever as we move forward. And just to sort of paraphrase the report that I gave you, I have been meeting with a variety of department heads over the past 2 weeks. I think I'm halfway. And so it's taking a little longer than I anticipated, but I'm spending a good 2 to 3 hours with each of the departments and meeting all the staff that's in the various locations as well. And as you know, I've met all five of you individually, and I thank you for the time that you devoted to me to share your thoughts. So that will continue. Obviously, the budget is going to be a challenge. I met Representative Cantwell tonight, who is here for office hours, and we talked about that at length and what he sees happening at the state level. And, you know, it has to be our priority. It has to be looked at regularly in terms of changing snapshot. And Tony and I have talked about meeting with the Revenue Forecasting Committee and sitting down with Mary after she finishes closing out FY09, which is a lot of work in the accounting department. So anticipate probably having semi-regular updates with you on that. I am scheduled to meet with Dr. Martin tomorrow morning to go over and really chat with her for the first time about school needs and how we can work cooperatively together, particularly I think in the area of IT, which some of you have articulated to me. But so far it's going very well, and reading through files and reading through historical issues, but both Sheila and Kim have been very helpful, and we'll keep plugging away. So thank you. And I got lost again today, but I'm getting a little better each time.
You're honest.
Metaphorically, or?
Down the harbor, and I thought for sure the road I went was running parallel to First Parish. I know that even if I have to drive like 3 miles, there's three roads that I know get me everywhere.
Yeah.
So I'm doing a big right angle. So.
Don't feel bad. Joe still gets lost.
Well, that's good. We're thrilled with the outreach that you've started, the participation and meeting everyone. So important, not only for you, I think, but probably equally as important for staff and management and employees to know that obviously you care and you're interested in their concerns. So we appreciate your reaching out to them.
Thank you. We have our first monthly department head Thursday with all department heads. And then the staff meeting that traditionally a smaller group happened on Tuesdays is really going to focus on development review. Okay. And be a little more formalized in terms of minutes and notes as to where various projects are in the review process and what potential issues or challenges they are, so we can track them on a more formal basis.
Right. Thank you. Other business for the board? Who wants to start it off? Anybody? Sean.
Just a couple of quick things. We got a letter from a woman that, you know, twisted her ankle walking out of the laundromat in Cole Parkway. And the reason I mention this is, you know, I run around there all the time and don't even give it a second thought, like all of us probably do. But about a week or so ago, I might have mentioned it to Kim, something similar to this happened in the front of CVS. And I just, ask Al if I'd meet you down there. We could take a look at the sidewalks. I don't know if it's from when we did Front Street, if those wide sidewalks, the joints are settled, if they're settling, they're concrete, if they're cracks, I don't know. But, you know, I think a police officer even helped this woman who fell coming out of CVS in the front. And then I read that something similar happened in the back. Yes. And it was, you know, I just, it's not that old. And, you and I probably walk over it every single day. Don't even give it a second thought, a second look. I know I don't. But sometime I'd be happy to meet you down there. And secondly is a letter that we got from another resident about difficulty in parking. And it's probably only going to happen a few times a year at the beach parking lot. But does anyone know, maybe Trisha may know, may not know, can we do anything more than a $15 parking violation?
Can we increase the fee?
The fee, or even have the car towed?
Remember, I brought this up a couple months ago when I got a tiny ticket down in Falmouth, and I asked what our fee was, and I agree. If our fees are low, we should move.
Well, on. I mean, I think this person's point was, you know, the person remained in the parking lot all day for $15 and still.
But I'm not sure it is 15. I think it's.
Is it 50?
It was raised to 40.
All right.
Good.
Oh, I'm sorry, 15 vehicles. Okay, all right. So
it was packed on Saturday. It was, the first warm day. both lots were completely full, people were parking on the street. I think the person suggested towing. There's no way to get a tow truck into those lots when they're as full as they are.
All right.
But the ticket, you know, would be only a deterrent.
All right.
I don't know how much higher.
It's 40?
40's.
40 now.
40's probably about right.
Yeah. All right.
After that, you.
All right.
Yeah, no good.
Kim, we.
It was raised just, I think, before last.
And it's probably only going to happen, like Tony said, a few times a year.
I have to interject for a second. What's the, and Kim, forgive me, it's usually my wife who gets it, the beach sticker. What's the cost of a beach sticker?
It's $20 by mail and $25.
Okay. So $40 is the penalty if you might as well get your, makes sense. Okay.
Oh, I see what you mean.
I guess the thought would be, is there any more parking down there? Is there any way to get any more parking in those areas? I don't think there's any other.
In Minot,
you have the secondary lot in Minot,
right.
But that floods. So if you're at high tide, if you park on the wrong side.
You need a duck boat.
Yeah. Kim?
Excuse me. I've not had this complaint in our office in the 15 and a half years I've been in this position. This was the first summer that I've had a complaint that people couldn't find a place to park at the beach. And I don't know if it is because the weather's been so terrible. Minot. And whether there's some out-of-town people they're willing to pay the $40, you know, for the privilege to go to one of our beaches. I'm
right.
Not really sure.
Right.
It was unusual.
All right.
I didn't get the sense that it was a lot of out-of-town people. I thought it was just full. You know, it was just a nice, first nice day, I think.
On a weekend. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. That's
you
all.
Get boots? Put the boots on their car.
The Scituate boot.
John, anything?
Yes, I just wanted to say that one was thanks to DPW and for also the contractors who went down to Sand Hills. I understand that it was determined that it's a health risk for the lifeguards as well as, you know, the area. The seaweed had been literally piled up on Sand Hills. They did an excellent job last Friday to try to clear it and get rid of it, and so I commend them for it. Also, I attended last week the Humorock Beach Association's annual event, whereby, you know, both Lieutenant Coyle, Officer Donovan, Mr. Arbansky from the Conservation Commission, Jen Sullivan from the Board of Health, and also Florence Choate from Council on Aging, as well as the chair. It was a very engaging meeting that we had. A lot of issues came up, a lot of issues pertaining to streets and sidewalks and things of that nature. I thought it was well attended by the residents, and they expressed some concerns. I know that I told that our new town administrator will be going down next Thursday at the fire station to take questions, field questions at 7 o'clock, and again remind those people, but I want to thank everybody for their participation. The other thing I was going to mention was that I received an email from Lose the Training Wheels as a part of CORE's, one of their events that they do, and I wanted to give them acknowledgement that this is the only, shall we say, event or I guess you could say seminar that's given here in Massachusetts, and this is the second year running that CORE's has done this, whereby children who to some extent have disabilities are trying to, shall we say, learn how to ride a bicycle. And I commend them for doing this. It's amazing that they're the only, shall we say, organization in Massachusetts that offers this. And I know that my nephew had the benefit of learning that in New York. So I commend the CORE's for doing it. Finally, I'll let Mr. Murray talk about the event that both he and I attended last week at the fire station. But I just wanted to thank firefighter Helena, as well as Captain Elliott, for their hard work in getting the town the recognition that Mr. Murray will mention. And that's it.
Thank you. Before we go to the other end, if I may just jump in on the CORE's thing. I mean, if anybody wants to see good people doing good things, attend that bike riding session at the Gate School. It's enlightening, eye-opening. I can't think of enough adjectives to describe it, but it's probably one of the most, one of the nicest things I have ever been able to witness. So it's just a wonderful, wonderful program. And if you can do anything to help them in any way, shape, or form financially, do it. Rick Murray, go ahead.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. I got several things here. First, Some good news, we got a letter from the Massachusetts Historical Commission informing us that the WPA Fieldhouse has been accepted by the National Park Service, Department of the Interior, for listing on the National Register of Historic Places. I know a lot of people for a long time have been working really hard on that project, including our own Historical Commission and various other citizens from North Scituate and around town. It's nice to get the confirmation that, that's now there. So that's on the good side. Also, following up with what Mr. Danny, he said, we did have the pleasure of going down to the fire station headquarters where the National Weather Service came and recognized Scituate as a storm-ready community. There's several requirements that the emergency, both Massachusetts and federal emergency, require towns to have in terms of communication and outreach and education about how to deal with basically natural hazards. Obviously, in our community, it's centered around coastal hazards. And they had a very nice ceremony. They gave us a nice letter and certificate of recognition, which I'll pass on to Tricia. David Ball was there and a number of people. And I just thought, as Danny, he said, it would be Al Elliott from the fire department really did a much of the heavy lifting on this. And I think it might be a good idea if we could maybe write him a letter from the board expressing our thanks to them.
We can do that.
And getting that
should,
out there.
Should include, and I forgive me for not remembering her last name, but also firefighter Helena.
Yeah, Elena
Shepherd. She was well, right. She was also one of the persons who spearheaded.
Good point. It was a real nice thing. I mean, there were a lot of people from FEMA and MEMA that came down and were there. Nice coffee and crumpets as well. On a less positive thing, there's a letter in the or a story in the newspaper about our friend the MBTA potentially cutting back on South Shore public transit, in particular the ferry boats. And as everybody here is aware, I take the ferry boat, so I'm particularly dialed into this. And I've received a lot of comments from people when I'm taking the ferry boat in and out, how they're outraged that the MBTA is even considering cutting back on these services. And the MBTA is also holding three public hearings, August 10th, August 12th, and August 27th, in Boston, Braintree, and Boston again, respectively. And a person far more suspicious than I might suggest that August 10th, August 12th, and August 27th isn't really going to capture a lot of people, because that's a pretty high vacation time. And also, none of these hearings are actually really on the South Shore, although Braintree is sort of on the South Shore. They aren't really tapping into the Hingham, Cohasset.
This is the Braintree one.
The Braintree one is August 12th in the evening.
I'd like to suggest that, and very happy you brought that up, I'd like to suggest that we write a very strong letter, if the board concurs, voicing our disapproval of the elimination of that boat.
Yeah.
And if at all possible, one of us take it to the August 12th meeting, and I don't know my schedule, but I'll volunteer to do that.
I am out of town, otherwise I would be delighted to go
and ask
to their forehead.
And read that letter at that meeting. If the board concurs that cutting out the ferry boat is a bad idea.
Yeah.
Does anyone have an objection to that?
No, I don't know.
So why don't we, Kim, you and I will get together on that, all right?
And Joe, I'll send you guys an email on this, telling you the date and the time and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, maybe you could leave that with Kim, that article,
sure.
Just so we're
right
to write our letter on.
Yeah, it's outrageous, particularly in the context of, you know, you pick up the Patriot Ledger, and the headline there is MBTA officials say they have identified defects in 4,000 concrete ties. It could affect as many as 150,000 ties, and the repairs of that could run $100 million. And here they are thinking about.
That's why they left them in Greenbush.
Yeah,
yeah.
That's right.
Thank
so
you
that's it
for
me,
up.
Mr. Chair. And I really support the idea about the boat letter. Thank you.
Tony?
Just a couple quick things. Last Friday, I attended the Scituate Police golf tournament. And in between raindrops, it ended up being a really good event. I think there were about probably just under 100 participants. And it was a good time and good fun. And I think they raised some good money for some good charities. I know Little League and some of the other local charities go from those funds. So thank them for running that good event. While on the topic, just want to give a little kudos out to all the Little League baseball teams and summer ball teams that are playing. Just so all you people on TV land know that you're being very well represented in the local tournaments and the local leagues. The 12A team did a wonderful job in the Williamsport tournament. And if you're bored on any evening over the next couple of weeks, just go down to Roach Field or Greenbush and you can see a wonderful game going on. A lot of teams are in the playoffs now and it's really good fun to watch. And lastly, we've brought this up a number of times, but I think we got another email on the grass and the rotary. Just to reiterate to everybody, that is not the town of Scituate's responsibility. It's Mass Highway, although I know Al is going to be taking care of it this week if they don't get on top of it, as they said they have. But we're just as frustrated as you. We drive by it and see that it looks horrible. But again, it's Mass Highway's responsibility, not the town of Scituate's. And I don't know, Al, do you have?
Al, go ahead. Go ahead.
Mass Highway says that it's the MBTA's responsibility.
Right.
But Mass Highway has agreed that they'll be out there before Friday to get the thing mowed. Right. And they also support the idea of having a local landscaper, I think Kennedy's has offered, to take over responsibility for landscaping it as well as maintaining it. Now, that's not signed on the line yet because they claim that the MBTA hasn't yet released it to them or they haven't accepted it, but that's in the works. So I think we're moving towards a really good solution, and in the next few days, we're going to get at least the basics done, which they're going to mow it.
Good job. And can they put some good grass seed in before they pass it along to Kennedy's?
I don't know if Kennedy's wants that grass.
John?
You know, they're going to have to work out a way to get on the island, obviously. They know that.
That's their job.
It's all granite curving around it.
Tony?
That's all.
I have a few items that I just want to talk very briefly about. One, I want to, a lot of times the lifeguards at our beaches take some criticism, and many, quite often it's unjustified criticism. I happen to be down the beach myself, just two of the beaches, actually, during the past couple of months and a couple of weeks, and I marveled at the attentiveness of the lifeguards that were on the beach. The time that I was there, and the observation that I had, not that I was staring at them in any way, shape, or form, but they didn't take their eyes off that water for 2 seconds. Standing right at water's edge, doing their job, having the lifeguard equipment with them. I just wanted to take note, before the season's over, sometimes they're criticized by people who don't fully understand that they're an emergency person. They're not there to watch your children. They're there to do something quickly if something happens to your child. You know, it's still your responsibility if you're sitting on the beach to keep your eye on your three-year-old with the boogie board. And these people men and women do a great job. So I just wanted to bring that up and not belabor it. But
Joe, you may want to mention the memo we got about the beaches, the lifeguards stopping at different times, too, that'll be posted, I think, in the paper.
Oh, yeah.
I was going to read that under correspondence.
Because of the you're right. Thank you, Tony. The lifeguards, over the next month or so, will be leaving the beaches. They go back to school. It's a constant situation just about every summer. They leave starting after August, and one by one the lifeguards leave the particular beaches. So be aware of that when you go down to the beach, that the beach that you're at may not be covered. Thank you for bringing that up. We do have an item here. We have a report, and I don't know if everyone got this. I think you probably did. It was dated last Friday, the 31st. It's a report from Jeff Dugan from the Massachusetts Architectural Access Board, and he also is on our own handicap commission. Without going into the whole thing, what it says, it's got to do with the Harborbrook Meadow, the Herringbrook Meadow trails, etc., and the bridge up in that area. It lists numerous concerns he has for his status as on the Handicap Access Board. Concerns that, in his opinion, are going to cost a considerable amount of money. And I'm not sure that anyone has this into their plans. I would like to, rather than go forward and start construction down the road and find out it's going to cost us another X number of dollars that we don't have, I'm going to suggest that we just put that project on hold now until we get a better feel for what this report means and the cost of this report, and ask that no further money be spent on this project until we determine what this, exactly what this means.
Where do we stand right now? Is it, it's already, has it been designed and?
It's been engineered, I think.
The bridge, you're talking about the bridge.
Just the bridge. I mean, don't even spend any money on the design.
No, I mean, I'm saying stop everything right now until we find out where we're at.
Okay.
Okay.
Another thing, Joe, that struck my eye was not only is there an upfront cost to get it in working order, but it kept saying maintenance, which is going to be, you know, an annual expense to keep it in some sort of condition. So,
if the board would agree, that would be my thought, that we just put it on hold.
I would agree with you. I think we suggested that 2 years ago, and of course, you know, it went before the town. The town opted to place the money of $30,000-$35,000 to do a consultants to determine what the cost and the engineering of this is. In conjunction with that, you know, with Mr. Dugan's suggestions, I was hoping that maybe we could address some of the concerns that are presently on the ground. Number one is there's no handicap parking space. So if somebody goes down there with a van, there's no place, shall we say, designated. Second thing was, apparently, even if somebody wanted to go down with a wheelchair, they can't because of a boulder, so they can't even go down the path. These are probably easy solutions that can be fixed. I think he also suggested there was a picnic bench, which is great. And unfortunately, it's not on any type of ground, or it's on ground, but it's not on anything that's accessible, you know, concrete. If there's something we could maybe think about in the future to address it with what we have, I think it shows that with something that we already have, we don't have it, it's not compliant. It begs the questions whether or not we should be even going forward with something even down the road. So if we could address that, it would be very helpful, Tricia.
We'll put it on hold for now and see where we go with it. So Al, if, I don't know if you have any input in this, do you?
Yep. That.
Would you?
Yes.
Would you? Thank you.
Should we also communicate that to the conservation?
Well, I think Al's going to do that.
Okay.
Al's going to do that. Okay. Through Tricia, through Al, through conservation. And you can have a copy of that email.
Okay.
All right. But the only other thing that I wanted to touch on, and it came up a little bit on the common vic for the market. Somewhere down the road, we're going to have to make a decision on that North Scituate parking lot. I mean, to have it sitting there now, absolutely vacant, this doesn't make any sense. I have no idea, no suggestions, no thoughts, no anything. But to have a parking lot that size that we are not responsible for, but we are supposedly taking the money, which there isn't any money to take in. I mean, do we want to, and I guess this will be the subject of that discussion, do we want to just have that parking lot sit there and weeds grow in it and become a graffiti-filled empty space? Or do we want to look and see what options we do have? And I have no idea what options we have or haven't, so it's not something I have in mind. It's just, it's a big hunk of North Scituate that we should really think about doing something with if we can. That's all.
Yeah, I think we should put that on some agenda in the future. I couldn't agree more. I don't know what the options are, how much we're bound to have that as part of our agreement with the MBTA, if any, and what the alternatives could be, whether we do something keeping it a parking lot but we use it differently, or we develop that land for some local businesses or something. I think it would be a great idea to have some discussion about that at some point.
That's just discussion. I don't think anyone knows what we're going to do with it, if anything. But
yeah.
All right,
and
thank you.
I would probably say, Joe, that maybe before even having a discussion, we can discuss anything, but why not refer it to town council to see what we can do within the documents?
Well, I mean, that would be part of the, you know what I mean? Yeah, I agree.
I think right away, then we'd know what we can do, what
we can
can't
do. Maybe
then,
that's the first step to...
And then from there, have it, discussion.
Get a hold of Jim, two of me, and pass it around.
You're under an obligation through the mitigation agreement. That it be a commuter rail parking lot.
Yeah, I know.
I think that needs to be tackled first before the reuse of it can change.
And they're under obligations to cut the grass, too. They don't do that.
Yeah. And, you know, the permit right now is not going to keep the lights lit. But...
Let's see. Let's just see.
You know, it's a topic to just explore what needs to happen before you have options.
Yeah, I do have some thoughts keeping the park a lot. I even have some thoughts there. So. All right. Correspondence, I don't think there's any...
I was just going to mention, in conjunction with your talking about the beach, some of the beaches and the lifeguards going off and so on and so forth, mm-hmm. if I might. Just to let people know, obviously, we're getting towards the end of not the end of the summer, but we're halfway through it, which means we're going back to school. And so, as a result, some of the lifeguards are not going to be at certain locations. So, just so that people are aware, if you're going to Gannett, and going to Minot, rather, as of Tuesday, August 4th, at the end of Minot, they will no longer be lifeguards. Now, that's not in the where the rocks are, but we're talking about closest towards Gannett. As far as Sand Hills Beach is concerned, the lifeguards will cease to exist. Well, they'll exist, but the point is they're no longer going to be looking, and the lifeguards will no longer be patrolling the beach after Sunday, August 16th. So as of the 17th, Monday, there will be no lifeguards at the Sand Hills Beach. And as far as Egypt Beach is concerned, Thursday, the 20th, will be the last day that they will be patrolling the beaches in Egypt. Hummer Rock, they will be there until Tuesday, August 25th. Obviously, thereafter, they won't. And as I said to you, the Well Rock, that end of Minot Beach, they will be patrolling it, sitting there until Tuesday, September 1st, 2009. And as far as Peggotty Beach goes, they will be there until Monday, September 7th, 2009. So if people could, you know.
And that'll be that'll be posted in the papers.
One other thing, I know that we got it and we can talk about it another date, but from the General Administration, General Services Administration, about the Minot Lighthouse and how they're looking. Put it up for sale. Did anybody read that at all?
I've had conversations with Doug Smith from the historical.
I just commission. Only want to say right up front. Obviously, it's something that is a it's going to go up. That the National Lighthouse, you know, what's it called? The National Historic Lighthouse Preservation Act. It's got to go up for sale. The long and short of it is, it's a concern I have because while the U.S. government is looking to, shall we say, sell it, it's going to be a huge cost and a drain to maintain it and keep it. So, you know, it's an issue that, you know, they're going to sell it to something. There are a whole bunch of covenants and restrictions that have to be maintained if somebody decides to buy it. And, you know, I just raise it now because it's interesting. I just don't want to see the town of Scituate end up saying, well, let's buy it, and then we're going to be basically having a sinkhole because to maintain a building of that structure way out in the middle of the
I don't think you're going to have that
ledge.
Yeah.
You know,
I don't think that's going to surface.
But having said that, I just thought it was kind of interesting to see, and in any event, that's
like I was saying, the Historical Commission brought that to our attention, and because there are a lot of people that do want to do this and buy them and get involved, but it is a historical spot, so
yep.
It's an interesting thing.
Minutes?
Move the minutes of June 9th, 2009, and July 21st, 2009.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Before the adjournment, Kim, our next meeting is?
The 25th of August.
All right. Entertain a motion with
move that the Board of Selectmen vote to adjourn this meeting at 8:15.
Second.
Motion been made. Seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Good night, folks. Thank you.
Good night. Thank you.